Welcome to ProScan Imaging's vignettes, in which we intend to capture very quick and small but focused topics in medicine. And our first series is going to concentrate on radiology, imaging, and specifically advanced imaging. And we're going to start out with an area that has been challenging for most physicians, namely the shoulder. So let's get right to it. We're going to start out with the rotator cuff, which is a site of common injury for most people in middle age and in youth. And even as you age, as the shoulder degenerates, this structure becomes more stiff and less vascularized, and there's a little less water in it, so it's more prone to break and crack. So it's not uncommon to see chronic degenerative incidental tears in this tendinous structure, but it's going to be important for you to differentiate those that are traumatic and symptomatic versus those that are incidental. So let's get started. And I'd like to begin with showing you some of the microanatomy of a tendon. And imagine for a minute that this is the rotator cuff tendon, which is actually a series of tendons and a myotendinous complex, as well as the capsule and a few other structures, as you'll see in a minute. Let's focus on the tendon. If we look at the tendon, it's composed of a series of bundles. And unfortunately for us, imaging has gotten so good that we can look inside these structures and see the individual subbundle structure anatomy. So we can see when there is degeneration or intrasubstance injury in ways that we could never see before. So we begin with a tertiary bundle, which is composed of secondary fiber bundles called fascicles. And then beyond these fascicles are primary bundles, subfascicles. The subfascicle level can be seen using MR microscopy imaging, in other words, very high resolution MRI. But for standard MRI, you're going to be able to see the tertiary bundle and the secondary bundle. And then when you get all the way out here at the microscopic level, you'll be able to see collagen fibers under the microscope, although microscopes may be a thing of the past, and then collagen fibrils. Another key point. Depending upon how the shoulder is positioned, the tendon may be straight or it may be a little bit crooked. What we aim to do when we set up for a rotator cuff study and analysis is to keep the tendon as straight and as taut as we can without too much curvature. For curvature on an MRI breeds signal change, false signal change, that can create an overdiagnosis of a tear. This signal change with bending is known as magic angle effect, or the anisotropic artifact, or the 55-degree artifact. But more on that, that's a story for another day. It's also important to observe when these fibers, and tertiary fibers, and fibrils crimp. In other words, when you position the shoulder correctly so that the fibers should be straight, but they're not. Well, there may not be an observable communicating tear from the deep articular surface to the superficial bursal surface, within the tendon, there is damage so that the fibrils, the intrasubstance components, instead of being straight, begin to do this. Now, they may not come apart, but they start to bend and curve. And we refer to this phenomenon as crimping. It's very important to observe crimping. One way you can tell whether crimping is important or significant is to go to a water-weighted image and see if there's swelling or inflammation in the tendon about those sites of crimping. Now here is another diagrammatic look at any tendon, although for the purposes of discussion today, we'll pretend this is a shoulder tendon. We said within the tendon are individual bundles, the tertiary bundle, and those can be further broken down. You can have tears within the substance of the tendon between these tertiary bundles. You can have tears at the subunit level as well within the bundle. But let's stay with the tears that are between the bundles. If such a tear is linearly oriented, but it only goes out one surface, it can be the upper surface, the horizontal surface, it can even be the lower or inferior surface, if it does so, but it doesn't go out both sides, only one side, and has this laminar shape, separating and perhaps distorting the subunit bundle, we call this a laminar or delamination type tear. In contrast, if a linear or laminar tear goes out both sides, whether it be the upper side, the bursal side, or the bony or articular side, or even goes from side to side and comes out both the medial and lateral side, both sides, we refer to that as a split tear. An important difference. Remember that these tears are very narrow, so they'll be difficult to appreciate if you only image in this projection tangent to the orientation of the tear. At some point, you're going to have to be perpendicular to that tear to appreciate its true nature. So in summary, split tears come out both sides of the tendon, whereas delamination tears may violate one surface, the other surface, or no surface at all. They may be totally intrasubstance in character. Now let's keep moving forward and look at a gross anatomic inspection of shoulder anatomy. And we're going to focus right now on the rotator cuff. You see in green that ligaments have been labeled for your perusal and educational interest. I'm going to focus primarily on the cuff itself. The cuff consists of a muscle-tendon unit. The tendon inserts variably on the end of the humerus. There is more than one tendon that makes up the rotator cuff. Here we are displaying one of the most important tendons, the supraspinatus muscle, myotendinous junction, and then the tendon. We'll see later on that the arrangement of the tendons in the shoulder can be variable in terms of their curvature, in terms of their overlap, and specifically in terms of the size of their footprint, namely the footprint of insertion on the bone at the end of the tendon. This footprint is the most common place where you're going to see rotator cuff pathology. It may not be surgical pathology. It may or may not be symptomatic pathology, but it is for sure the most common place to see abnormalities. We also have another component of the rotator cuff that is partially seen here depicted in blue, and that's the biceps tendon. It contributes somewhat to rotator cuff stability, especially as it enters the joint and goes back to the superior aspect of the glenoid. The joint capsule, which is not fully seen here, but some of the ligaments in front of it that contribute to the joint capsule also contribute to rotator cuff stabilization. We'll see a little bit later on that the infraspinatus, the teres minor, the supraspinatus, the coracohumeral ligament, the biceps, and the capsule, these are all contributors to the rotator cuff stabilization mechanism. Now let's look at a little bit of shoulder theory. This will be the last thing we cover in this vignette. This is one of the variations that we described. Let's just take one of the tendons, namely the supraspinatus, and let's follow it from medial to lateral, lateral being the footprint insertion. Now, at the footprint insertion, there is no hyaline cartilage on top of the humeral head. There's no joint space here. So it's improper to call a tear here an articular surface tear. It's a humeral or cortical surface tear. More medially, this is the joint space. So this area is covered by hyaline cartilage. There is synovium and capsule in this region, with one caveat. Many people have a small area right here that is devoid of hyaline cartilage. We haven't drawn this in yet, but this area is called the bare area. Now, tears that occur in this locale, medial to the footprint or foot plate, especially if they communicate with the articular surface, will be visible. So these are non-concealed tears, whereas tears that are seen in the foot plate itself, even if they go to the humeral head, these are concealed tears. And if they're linear or laminar, we may call them concealed, interstitial, laminar or delamination tears. And sometimes they get the abbreviation CID. So hidden and non-hidden. Now next time we come back for our next vignette, we're going to talk more about shoulder theory, and we're going to examine the individual components of a tendon in the shoulder from medial to lateral. We're going to name them and show you some of the variations and how they can affect what a rotator cuff tear does, how it retracts, and how it looks. Thanks a lot, and we'll see you next time.